Matthew Boulton built James Watt's new high-tech steam engines in the late 18th century. He proudly said, "I sell here what all the world desires to have, power." Well, that was a bit over the top. But power is what we need to drive LNG refrigeration units. And the spawn of Watt's engines today is the gas turbine, a key part of a modern LNG plant. Many people seized on the turbine concept during the 17th century scientific revolution. That was long before Watt's steam engines. Giovanni Branca suggested a complete steam turbine-driven system as early as 1629. Commercial turbines finally emerged very suddenly at the end of the 19th century. Turbines driven by burning gas rather than steam appeared at the outset of the 20th century. They're now widely used to drive refrigeration compressors in LNG plants. Another form of the gas turbine was the airplane jet engine, developed just before World War II. Now certain features of the airplane jet have been adapted to create higher performance land-based turbines, what we call aeroderivative turbines. Liquefaction plant designers now have a choice of ever more efficient and powerful compressor drivers. The LNG industry first used gas turbines in 1969. It was in Kenai, Alaska, and those turbines changed everything. They were faster to build, smaller, cheaper to install, they didn't need cooling water, and talk about reliable, we're still using them today. The next three decades have seen new generations of more powerful, more efficient heavy-duty gas turbines in LNG plants. They were good news for an industry that wanted lower costs and economies of scale. They enabled ever larger LNG plant capacities. Then, in 2006 in Australia, a breakthrough. The Darwin LNG plant began using aeroderivative gas turbines. The LM2500 gas turbine was adapted from turbofan aircraft engines, engines that had also been used in warships. The LM2500 proved to be a real fuel saver. And that's important in a world concerned with climate change. Aeroderivative gas turbines can reach 50% better efficiency than some gas turbines used in LNG production. And they can reduce the turbine's CO2 output by a quarter or more. Those turbines let us reduce the overall energy supply to the LNG plant by about 3%. But for sheer power, conventional heavy-duty gas turbines still rule. They power the two largest LNG plants in the world. Alternate systems have also emerged. Norway's Snøhvit LNG plant went online in 2006. With electric motors driving its compressors, and aeroderivative turbine generators power the electric motors. Since the 1980s, we've gone from two choices for compressor drivers to many choices, and now improved thermal cycles are promising to offer even greater choice in the future. We do have much to consider in choosing a compressor driver. What's right for one company, for one process, may be wrong for another. And it's clear how much we've built upon those early engines. The ingenuity of people like Branca and Watt is alive today in the complex business of providing power to make natural gas into a liquid.